Well, good morning and welcome. We're glad that you're here with us today. Everybody that's here, and for all of you who are joining us at home, we are thrilled that you're a part of our time of worship. We like to begin with a special time for our kids. So kids, if you're at home, gather around the TV or the device. And children that are here, we're so glad that you're here with us today. I don't know, do you ever become frightened? Do you ever find that you're afraid? There's several different things in life that make some children and make me frightened at times. Sometimes it's a place that I might go, or maybe a really tall item on the playground. When I used to go to amusement parks, I was pretty frightened of some of the rides there. Sometimes it was an appointment I had to go to, and sometimes even school scares some children when you have people you don't know. There's a lot of places and things that oftentimes frighten us. When I'm frightened, I found a few things that help. One of the best is if I can go to that place or do that event with somebody I know that I love. And that makes me not quite as frightened at all. And as we live life, sometimes there are moments where we find ourselves a little bit afraid. And in a very real way, Jesus walks through life with us. And most importantly, he walks with us into eternity, into the presence of God. So if you find yourself a little frightened, even though you can't physically see Jesus, it's nice to know that he's always there with us. Listen to this beautiful verse in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 12. In Christ, we can come before God with freedom and without fear. We can do this through faith in Christ. It's nice to know that Jesus walks with us. That's true for children and for all of us as adults. Isn't it nice to know that we'll even walk into the throne room of God with Jesus in our presence, with no fear? God bless you for being here this morning. We do love you. Let's sing about how good God is. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
Good morning. It's good to see you. Welcome to the Edmond Church of Christ. If you're in this building, if you're watching online, we want to welcome everyone to this time of worship together. It is good to see you, and it's good to be together. Whatever that looks like, it's good to have the opportunity to worship together, so we welcome everyone. Certainly to our guests, if you're visiting today, thank you for being here. If you're looking for a church home, we want to tell you about the Edmond Church of Christ. It's a group of people who love each other and love God, and we do our best to serve him. And so we'd love to have you walk alongside us here. If you are a first-time visitor here, maybe you're new to the community, please go by and see Kevin. He is at the Welcome Center after our service today. He has a special gift for you. And so be sure to go see him if you're a first-time guest today. But we want to welcome all of our guests and visitors. You see the QR code on the screen. Don't hesitate to take out your phone and let us know you're here. Just take a picture of that or go to the little site that it takes you to answer a couple of questions. There's also a link in your bulletin, your online bulletin. The codes are also out in the lobby. So before you leave today, be sure and let us know that you are either here participating in worship or watching online. Either way, members and guests alike, we're so thankful to have you a part of this time together. Also, if you need a mask or you need a communion packet, if you wouldn't mind, just raise your hand. We have some ushers who'd be happy to give you either one of those. Thank you so much for wearing your mask. Thank you for trying to social distance in here. Obviously, things are not going in the direction we want them to go in our world and in our nation and our state as far as this pandemic. But we are prayerful. And we are hopeful. And our hope is not in vaccines, although we probably would welcome that. Our hope is in God. And that's what our current series is all about, is where we place our hope and what that looks like in our lives. And so it's a good reminder. Every time we are disappointed, every time things don't go like we have planned, it's a good reminder of where we put our hope. Last night, if you got to be a part of the outdoor prayer service, a time of hope and healing, it was such a wonderful time together. We had several that sat in their cars and several that pulled up chairs. And as you can see, just like in here, no one sits on the front row, but that's okay. I just want to thank all the ministry staff, all the volunteers, all the guys who led prayer. So many people worked to make that happen last night, and God was certainly present, as He is always present. But He was certainly present in that moment as we called upon Him. I truly think that time was an anointed time and a gift from God. And so if you didn't get to be a part of that, we are going to hopefully soon post the video on our YouTube channel, and you can go there and watch that and participate in that as well. But thanks to everyone who was a part of that, either planning or pulling it off, and of course those who came to be a part of it. All right, let's worship together. It's good to be here. If you don't mind, go ahead and stand up. And if you need to move a little bit so that others can have room on your pew, our ushers can help find seats as people come in a little bit late. Don't hesitate to move a little bit. Let's read out loud from Psalm 86, verse 12, as we begin our time of praise and worship together. I will praise you, Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever.
Father, we love
today. Let's pray to God together. Father, we come to you today loving you and relying on you. Father, we know that you are so powerful, beyond our comprehension, Lord, that you can do amazing things, that we are here today because you can cleanse us from the wrongs, from the sins, and the things that would separate us from you, Lord. What amazing power you have to be able to do that for us and to us. Lord, we ask that you show that power more and more as we are concerned about our state and our nation, between this pandemic and whatever political issues are abounding. Father, we wish and we ask that you would make your presence known, that you would help us as a nation. Lord, we ask that you would continue to be with us and show us as believers of you and as your body, show us examples and opportunities that we might serve those around us so that we might share with them the same hope that we have in you, Lord. Father, we ask that your blessings be upon our college students this week as they will take their exams and then be traveling home. Lord, we ask that you would keep them safe as they are very precious to this body, that you would watch over them and that you would give them success in the things that they do. Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunities that you've given to us to bless your name, to praise your name, to glorify you. Truly, God, you are a great God who is worthy of our praise all the time. Father, we ask these things in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. find Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Thoughtful time of communion. And this week has been one of those times for me. Last week, a dear friend passed away. And so we spent this week remembering her and thinking about the times we had together. One of the fondest memories I have is being in her home as our families gathered to recreate the Passover meal. To go through the ceremony that the Jews would have gone through when they remembered their deliverance out of Egypt. And that was the same meal, the same festival that Jesus gathered with his disciples to recreate and to experience on the night he was betrayed and carried off to be crucified. So Christ sat with his disciples, and on that night, he took the unleavened bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so that's what we do this morning. Trey's going to lead us in a song, and then we'll have a prayer, and we'll partake of the bread.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my wretched soul shall find. Near the cross.
Let's pray together.
Lord God, we're so thankful for Christ. As we gather together, as we remember him, as we remember the sacrifice and the broken body that delivers us from sin, we're thankful and we're honored to be brought in to fellowship with you. It's in his name that I pray. Amen. Holy God and Father, we praise you and we thank you for this cup, the fruit of the vine, that cleanses us of our sins. We remember Christ and his blood spilling for us. Amen.
What a blessing what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. And we live as forgiven people in this world. I wanted to pause for just a moment and thank you so much for your generosity and the way you've been giving to the Lord's church, giving to God in these last months and over this year. We've done so well to keep up with expenses. We have fallen behind a little bit these last couple of months, and maybe there's a way that you can help us recover from those. But what I really wanted to talk to you about is your giving, especially in this season. Of course, you can give in our secure boxes as you leave here today. You can mail it in. But we've also been working to make our online giving easier and more secure. And so in the next few weeks, you're going to hear about us moving to a new online payment platform called PushPay. It's very easy. You could get out your cell phones right now and text the number 7797, send a text to that number, and in the message just write Edmond COC, and you'll be taken to that new platform page. It's very easy to set up your giving there. You can also go to our website, edmondchurchofchrist.com, and the button says Give Online, and it's going to take you to that same page. You'll hear more about it in the future. And while you're there, you can set up reoccurring giving, which is what Brenda and I do. And you can do it every week, twice a month, every other week, once a month. There's a lot of options there that you can choose. First time you do that, like if you're doing it right now on your phone, you'll just need to enter your banking account, which is what Brennan and I chose to do, or your debit card or your credit card, and then from then on it's in there, it's safe and it's secure, and you can give. You know, this church family is such a blessing to me and to my family. What God has done in our lives through this church family is incredible. And through our generous spirits, we're able to do so many things to bless our community. There are hidden things that happen in this community and in this church that we can't ever see because of our faithful giving. In benevolence, the way we reach out to our own members in a very quiet and private and appropriate way, and to our community as well. And then the way we use this building as a platform to reach into our community. You probably saw the pictures on during early voting when our building was literally wrapped multiple times. And we use this as a platform from which we can do so many things to reach this world. One of the things that pleases me the most about this church family is our love for our children. And the way we show that through our gifts and our giving. That's true for our children, our youth, our college kids, which are taking finals this week. God bless. I'm past that. So thankful. But they're going to be gone until after Christmas. And so we look forward to you returning. And please, just know from all of us here, you mean so much to us. So thanks so much for being a part of our church family this semester and for persevering alongside us through all that's been going on. But it's not just our young people and our young adults that we care about. It's our seniors as well. So much ministry happens, and it comes from the fact that God works through each of us to be a blessing. And so may God continue to open our hearts and find ways that we can be a blessing in this world on His behalf. And may all that we have, may our giving remind us that all that we have is truly His.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin.
Scripture reading this morning is going to be from Luke 24, verses 19 through 24. What things he asked about Jesus of Nazareth? They replied, he was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus.
Yeah. It is now time for a children's Bible hour for our 2-year-olds through the second grade. Masks are required, so if you'd like to have your child participate, please exit through the back doors as we sing this song. Would you stand, please? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant and his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all
before we jump into our sermon for today, let me join the other voices in saying a word to and about our college students. We know that many of you have finals this week. Not all of you are at OC, and we acknowledge that. Some of you are at UCO or other schools in the area, and we are so thankful that you are a part of our group too. Whether you're here or you're watching online, sometimes it's difficult when you feel like most everyone else goes to one particular school and maybe not as many people go to the school you go to, but you are a valuable part of this campus ministry and this church family, and certainly to our OC students. You mean so much to us. It's been an interesting semester. I know that none of us really knew what to expect. We knew it would be a challenge, but I just wanted to commend you for so many things, for staying committed, for doing all the things that you needed to do to get through the semester, and for most of all, for being committed to being a part of a church family when it would have been very easy for you just to sort of fade away. Thank you for being committed. Thank you for making worship and ministry and service and fellowship a priority. It's such an example to us. It's such an encouragement to us. And it's been different for us too, because we haven't really been able to have you in our homes. We haven't been able to do some of the things that we enjoy doing as a church family for and with our college students. But we get to see you every week, and we are so thankful to do that, and we're thankful for what you're doing. So just have a great break whenever that break begins, and we will be praying for you. We look forward to the time when we are back together again, and so our prayers for God's protection over you and his blessings over you as you finish up the semester, wherever you're in school, and as you go to break. So let me offer a word of prayer on your behalf. Let's join together and pray. Father God, thank you so much for our young men and women, those who are going to college, trade school, those who are in a transition period of their lives, ready to enter that next phase. Father, I'm thankful for the things that they are doing, the ways that you are revealing yourself and your will to them. Father, I'm thankful that they are a part of this church family and that they are an important part of this church family. The energy they bring, the enthusiasm, the way of thinking, their perspective, their faithfulness, and so many other things. Father, our prayer is that you would guide them and walk with them over the next week and weeks as they finish up this semester, that you would protect them over their break, that you would bless their time with family and friends and loved ones, and Father, that you would bring us back together so that we may continue to serve you and worship you with one voice as one body. So, Father, our prayer is for your protection and provision over our campus ministry. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. All right, if you have a Bible, you might open it up to Luke chapter 24. There's an Old Testament scholar named Walter Brueggemann, highly respected, and he came up with a three-phase approach to look at the Old Testament Psalms. And the three-phase approach was orientation, disorientation, and reorientation. And it's a great hermeneutical or a great interpretive lens to look at the Psalms of Israel's past, the Psalms that are in our Bible, because you get to see some of the different things they were going through as they express their heart in worship or lament. And so you get to see them sort of move through these different movements or these different phases. So it's a great way to interpret Scripture, but it's also a great way to interpret life. Orientation, disorientation, and a new orientation or reorientation. Because think about your own life. We all go through these movements. We all go through these different seasons of life when we seem to have everything going like we expect, and all of a sudden everything is turned sideways, and we try to adjust and try to make this what we always say is the new normal, the reorientation. And sometimes this process happens in a matter of seconds or minutes. Sometimes it's hours or days or weeks. Sometimes it's years. Sometimes it's a lifetime. But as you think about your own life, you can probably identify different seasons or different movements through these phases. And they probably vary in severity. You know, sometimes maybe you go through this and it's really not that big of a deal. And other times maybe it is catastrophic. It is a huge deal. I have an example for you. Two Fridays ago, I was in the backyard working on some limbs. In case you didn't know, our town had some tree damage recently. We all know that because we're all dealing with it. So I was out in the backyard and I was trying to take care of some of these limbs. And, you know, I have some physical limitations right now because I've had a few surgeries this year. Some of the things inside my body that are supposed to stay connected have come disconnected this past year, so we've had to reconnect them. And so I was a little bit limited physically, but I wasn't going to be out there that long, and I wasn't going to lift any huge branches, and so, you know, it wasn't that big of a deal. I was taking it very easy. I was being very smart, I thought. So evidently, I wasn't just physically limited, I was mentally limited for a few minutes. It wasn't my proudest moment. I know better. I usually wear gloves when I use a chainsaw. But for whatever reason, you know, I wasn't going to be out there that long. It's just small branches. I didn't wear gloves. And long story short, I ended up cutting my fingers with the chainsaw. I don't know if the finger is like the pour spout for all the blood in one's body, but that's what it felt like. I cut my fingers and they bled like a chocolate fountain at a wedding. I mean, that's what it looked like. Blood going everywhere. And in that moment, I was propelled into disorientation. I'm not kidding. I mean, before that moment, you know, we had plans for the evening. Everything was going to be fine. And now in that moment, everything had changed. And it wasn't pain that washed over me. It was intense frustration. I can't believe I did that. That was my first thought. I can't believe I did that. And then I started having all these questions. Are we going to have to change our plans for this evening? How much is this going to cost? How much hassle is this going to be? What is my wife going to say? And what if I cut something important? You know, tendons aren't exactly going well this year for me. What if I cut a tendon in my finger with that chainsaw? So I had all these questions. And that's what happens in disorientation. Everything is turned on its head, and you start to ask yourself all these questions. You start to question everything, because before that, you kind of understood everything. You knew what to expect. You knew what was going to happen. And now everything has changed, and you have all of these questions. And that's That's what I was doing. I was asking all of these questions. And that's when my intense medical experience and training kicked in. I was a lifeguard in high school. So I thought, okay, what do I do? Do I need a tourniquet? Well, it's not like I'm out in the wilderness. I'm 30 yards from my back door. I'll probably be okay. But I remembered, you know, elevate. Get that hand above your heart. And so I raised my hand, and I started to take off toward the house, and then I realized I should probably pick up my chainsaw. You know, take care of your tools. You don't want to leave them outside. You know, I could be in the hospital for days. What's going to happen to that chainsaw? I could get rained on. The armadillo could get it. So you can go back to YouTube and catch up on that. So I pick up the chainsaw with my right hand, but if you may remember, I've had surgery on my bicep tendon, and so I'm not supposed to lift heavy things, and so I'm sort of hugging it onto my leg. With my right hand bleeding up in the air, I'm walking to the back door. I mean, I look like something out of a horror movie, you know, chainsaw, bloody hand. I bust into the door and I say, I cut myself. I was so frustrated. And you know how expecting parents have the suitcase packed by the door ready to go? I think that's what Carrie Ann does now. She has my insurance card ready, her phone charger, a few quarters for the vending machine. Okay, let's go. And so off we go. And thankfully, I had a great doctor who put me back together. And I didn't cut anything important. It was just a few stitches. And so we were able to put my fingers back together. You can't see, I have Band-Aids over them right now. For your sake, that's good. I started to put a picture up there, but it wouldn't be good. And so thankfully, he put me back together, and everything's going to be okay. But you think about that, it's kind of a silly example, but maybe you can relate to this idea of orientation where everything is going just as you had planned, right? I mean, there are good things happening. You know what to expect. You have dreams and ideas and visions, and you can't wait for those to be achieved and fulfilled. Everything is status quo. You're in your routine. Things are going well. And then all of a sudden, disorientation. You're propelled into this movement of disorientation, and things are turned sideways, and you feel insecure, and you have questions, and you have doubts, and you don't know what you can count on, because all those dreams and all that status quo is now, you can't count on it. And many times people stay there. They never leave that disorientation. They live their lives in a constant state of confusion and anxiety and not knowing which way is up. But hopefully we move through that and we get to a new orientation, a reorientation, not the old orientation. I mean, after this experience a couple of Fridays ago, I can assure you I will not use a chainsaw without gloves again. You see, I have a new way of thinking. You say, well, shouldn't you have thought that way the first time? Yes, but it took that experience, maybe, for me to reorient my thinking, to think in a new way. And that's why that movement, that phase is so important, because it realigns our values. It causes us to rethink what we thought was true before. And so in Luke 24, we have another example of moving through these phases, this three-phased movement through perspective and thinking and worldview. It's at the end of Luke's gospel, and we pick up the story in 24 during disorientation. Jesus had been crucified just outside the city of Jerusalem just a couple of days before. And his triumphant disciples who entered the city with so much expectation and anticipation and joy and celebration are now dispersing in disappointment. They are disoriented. Jesus has been crucified. And so we catch up with a pair of sojourners on a road leading out of Jerusalem to a small town on the west side of Jerusalem called Emmaus. Luke chapter 24, verse 13. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. So let's pause there for a moment. We don't know the exact identities of these two travelers. We know one in the text is identified as Cleopas. And many scholars think he's probably the same one that's identified in John 19. The spelling is a little bit different, but we read that there is a woman, one of the Marys at the cross, her husband is Clopas. And most scholars think it's probably the same person. And so maybe here on the road to Emmaus is Clopas or Cleopas and his wife. Or some other scholars have said, well, maybe it's him and his son that tradition says is someone named Simeon. Or maybe it's Cleopas and a friend, a fellow disciple. We don't know for sure, but we know they're on the road. And we know that Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, joins them, these two disoriented disciples. But they don't recognize him. Now, for certain, Jesus is resurrected in bodily form, but something about his appearance makes it impossible or improbable to be recognized. Remember, Mary thought that maybe he was the gardener when she saw the resurrected Jesus at the tomb. And so these two don't recognize Jesus. Maybe for whatever reason, God keeps them from seeing Jesus as Jesus. They don't recognize him. What they know is their Jesus, their Messiah, their rabbi, the one on whom they had placed their hopes, was dead. They saw, they heard. He hung on a cross. He was taken, he was beaten, he was crucified. And so on the road, they are talking about all of this. And Jesus says, "Hey, what are y'all talking about?" And Cleopas seems startled by the innocent question. What are we talking about? Where have you been? We're talking about what everyone is talking about. Have you not been on social media? Check Facebook. It's all over it. We're talking about what happened to Jesus. And the resurrected Jesus says, what happened to Jesus? And I wonder if he had a little grin on his face when he asked that. Well, what happened to Jesus? Back in the text, verse 19, the second part of verse 19. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and all the rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. These two are skeptics at best, right? They are so confused. They are the definition of disorientation. Everything they thought was going to happen, everything they thought was true, has now been turned upside down, and they don't know what to think. Look at that phrase, those three words, we had hoped. Have you ever said those words? Have you ever thought those words? In the pit of your stomach, have you ever expressed those words to God? We had hoped to get pregnant. We had hoped to have a healthy child. We had hoped to get through this marital conflict. We had hoped for a better job. We had hoped for a new home. We had hoped that our children would grow up and be faithful. We had hoped that the doctor would have different news. We had hoped that the chemo and radiation would work. Maybe you know what those three words sound like coming out of your mouth, out of your heart. They say, we had hoped. You see, life on the front side of that phrase is completely different. It is agreeable. It is predictable. It is almost enjoyable. There is promise. There is anticipation. Hopes are high and the future is bright. On the front side of that phrase, we had hoped. For these two, the front side of that phrase was pre-Calvary. It was their orientation. Jesus had crowds clamoring. He had done all these miracles. He was going to be the Messiah, the one they had been waiting for. They had welcomed him into the city of Jerusalem, the holy city, praising him, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." They had cast all their hopes on him. He was going to deliver Israel, maybe make a new kingdom, develop an army, overtake Rome. That was their orientation. That was on the front side of these three words. But Friday happened. That dark day that saw the death of Jesus. And as they watched the life drain out of their Messiah, they felt the hope drain out of themselves. We had hoped. We had hoped he was the one. Just a few verses earlier, we see some of the disciples hear the report from Mary that Jesus has risen. But in verse 11, they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Maybe these two travelers bought into this nonsense. It can't be. He can't be alive. We saw him. We heard about it. Everyone's talking about it. He is dead. And it wasn't just that Jesus had been the object of their hopes and dreams and desires. Jesus should have been defeating the pagans and the powers of the day, not dying at their hands. They could not wrap their minds around what was happening. They were completely disoriented. Maybe you know what that feels like. Maybe if you are truly honest with yourself, you say, you know, that's where I am right now. This crazy COVID stuff, the political stuff, the election, that is where I am right now. I don't even know what to think. I don't know what's going to happen. Before all of this, everything was understandable. Everything was predictable. I was in control of my life. I knew what to expect, and now everything is just crazy. Maybe you know what it's like to be disoriented. Maybe it is the pandemic. Or maybe it's a situation at work or a family crisis. Maybe it's health concerns or the death of a loved one or the suffering of a loved one. Or maybe it's anxiety and uncertainty. And all of these things, or one of these things, or something else, has propelled you into this place of disorientation. And you don't know what to do. And you are walking on the road to Emmaus, and the text says, your face is downcast. And you utter those words, "We had hoped. We had hoped." A woman named Mary McLaurin has a very rare condition. It's called developmental topographical disorientation, DTD. Whereas most people have sort of a mental map in their heads, an internal compass, so you kind of know how to get around. I mean, I know some people don't know. I can't remember east, west, north, south. But you kind of know how to get around. And to some extent, you have a mental map in your head. Well, Mary had no mental map. This condition caused her to just never know where she was, basically. And one time she was staying at a friend's house and she took their dog for a walk. And she was just a few blocks from where she started, but she might as well have been 100 miles from home because she was lost. She didn't know where she was. She didn't know where to go. She didn't write down the address of the house, is what she normally did. So she had no clue how to get back. See, that's what it feels to be in this stage of disorientation. You look around and nothing is recognizable. She just simply needed something familiar, a landmark, or someone to say, "Here, let's find our way back." Someone to walk her home. Ultimately, that's what she found. Someone was able to help her eventually find her way back to this house. You see, disorientation is difficult. It is so difficult. But it can also be helpful. Because it sometimes forces us. We sometimes have to be in this place of disorientation for us to realize that we are not in control. disorientation causes us to pull over and to say, wait a second, am I going the right way? Who's driving this? I think I'm driving this. I forget God is in control. It causes us to reevaluate our priorities, to rethink our values. It causes us to possibly, hopefully, spend time in confession and repentance about ways of thinking, ways of acting that are dishonorable to God, but they just became status quo. That's just who we are. That's just part of what I do. And now all of a sudden, everything is questioned. And maybe it needs to be. I think in many ways for the church and for our nation over the past several months, it has not been enjoyable, but maybe on some level it has been useful. Because we have been confronted with some things that we probably need to be confronted with. And so disorientation can be helpful. I would encourage you to embrace the abruptness of disorientation, but don't stay there. Don't stay there. Like the woman, you need to get back home. You need something familiar, something known. You need capital T truth, not your truth and my truth and everyone else's truth. You need the truth. You need coordinates on a map. You need a compass. You need direction. You need someone to take you by the hand and take you home. That someone is hope. You see, our pilgrims on the road to Emmaus, they were disappointed. They were disoriented. They had lost hope. But what they didn't realize is that hope was right there with them. Hope was walking with them on the journey. Back in the text, verse 25, Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. You see, these two, they needed their hope to be resurrected and redirected. Their hope was in the right place, Jesus, but it was in the wrong expectation. Jesus as an earthly king, as an earthly Messiah. And so Jesus, without them even knowing at this point who he is, decides to help them find their way home. And so he opens up the scriptures and he explains who he is, the true nature of who he is. And he says, what happened should not have been a shock to you. You should not have completely come undone at the sight of Jesus dying. Our scriptures predicted it. They pointed to it. And if you look in the Gospel of Luke, on at least three separate occasions, Jesus says he's going to be taken by the authorities, he's going to be found guilty, and he's going to be crucified. They had no excuse. But they couldn't understand when they saw it happen. Why? Because that's not what they wanted. They couldn't accept it because it wasn't what they wanted. You see, when hope is anchored in our wishes, in our desires, it is hard to move. And maybe their entire orientation for life was based solely on what they thought, what they wanted, how they viewed the world. Not on a suffering Savior, but on a Savior who is going to deliver them from suffering. As N.T. Wright points out, the phrase from Cleopas, it's so close to being accurate. And just one slight change makes it accurate. Rather than they crucified him and we had hoped he was going to redeem Israel, it should be they crucified him and that is how he redeemed Israel. So close. And yet they weren't there because they couldn't allow themselves to go there. If you can't see hope, the truth is maybe you're looking in the wrong place. Hope was right there with them, walking with them. So as they approached the village, Jesus continued on and they implore him to stay with them, to stop, to not go on, to stay with him. And so he agrees to stay. He knew these two had finished their day's journey, but they had not reached the place they needed to go. So Jesus was willing to take them there, to take them to this new orientation. Back in our text, verse 30. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, it is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon. Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Man, stark difference between their two trips, right? On the way from Jerusalem, the text says their faces are downcast. You can almost imagine them dragging their feet. They are disappointed. They are disoriented. We had hoped. But now, on the way back to Jerusalem, they're running. They're skipping. They're excited. They can't wait to get there. Reorientation. It took having their eyes opened to Jesus. And maybe it was the sight and the sound of Jesus breaking and blessing the bread that became that familiar landmark for them. Or maybe it was in that moment where God just chose to open their eyes miraculously. Either way, they saw Jesus. They finally saw Jesus, and they finally saw hope. Here's what I want you to know, especially if you find yourself right now in a place of disorientation. Hope is always right there. Always right there with you. Just open your eyes. Just open your eyes. We lose hope because our hope comes from what we want rather than what God wants. We lose hope because our difficult circumstances blind us to Jesus. Because our difficult circumstances don't match up with our expectations and assumptions about life and about God and about faith. We lose hope because we listen to a world that, when given the chance, would rather crucify hope than cling to it. Hope that is anchored in Jesus will last. It will endure. It will endure hardships. It will endure suffering. It will endure anything that comes your way. It exceeds wishful thinking because it is grounded in the promises of God. That's why Peter wrote these words in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Let us thank the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It was through his loving kindness that we were born again to a new life, a new orientation, and have a hope that never dies. This hope is ours because Jesus was raised from the dead. That truth is the thesis statement for the story of the two sojourners on the road to Emmaus. Their hope was restored and put in the right place because Jesus was raised from the dead. You see, the resurrection becomes our reorientation for life. Hope is in the resurrection of Jesus. Don't get trapped in the sorrow of Friday or the confusion of Saturday. Jesus isn't on the cross, and he's not in that tomb. He is alive. He is walking among you, with you. This is Sunday, and Jesus is alive, walking with you. During this pandemic, it has certainly been a time of disorientation for many. It's been a time of intense suffering for some. But for many, it's been a time where things are just different. Schedules are different, routines are different, rhythms are different. We don't know what to expect. But maybe we should make the most of this disorientation. Maybe we should use this as an opportunity to pull over and to question some things, like our values, like our priorities, like who we think is really in control. Maybe it's a time for us to be propelled into a place of confession and repentance, of humility. We don't have to stay in disorientation. And it doesn't necessarily take a vaccine or a cure to get us through to the new orientation, the reorientation. It takes a change of heart and mind, a way of thinking. It takes opening our eyes to see Jesus the hope that is walking among us. So reorient your life and anchor your hope in Jesus. You find hope when you open your eyes. You know, we sang that old hymn right before the sermon, "My hope is built on nothing less." It was written actually almost 200 years ago, 1834, by a man named Edward Mote. Listen to the words again. "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all, my hope and stay. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand." Almost 200 years old, and yet those words are still true and relevant for us today. After Edward Mote wrote this song, a friend asked him to go visit his wife who was sick and dying, so he went over to see her. And usually when he visited someone who was sick, he would pray, he might even sing, or they would join together and sing a few hymns or songs. And so he was asked to sing, and he took out that crumpled piece of paper with those words that he had just written. And he sang these lyrics, these words to her. She asked him for a copy of those words. She wanted a reminder of where she stood, of where her hope was. She wanted reassurance in the face of death that her hope was in the right place. So he gave her a copy of the words. She died not long after that. You see, hope is always right there. Sometimes we just need to open our eyes and see him. Will you do that? It takes faith. It takes a reorientation of thinking and perspective sometimes. It takes humility. It takes surrender. Will you open your eyes and see Jesus? He's right there with you, walking with you, no matter where you're going, no matter what you're walking through. Hope is found in Jesus. It's built on nothing else. If we can serve you in some way or encourage you, if we can pray for you, let us do that. You can go to our website, the prayer page there, and fill out a prayer request. Or if you're here today, you can come forward. Maybe today you're ready to give your life to Christ. You know what Jesus did is real, and you believe in him. And your faith is in him, and you're ready to make that known to the world and to God, to surrender your life to Christ, to be baptized into Christ, to wear his name. We would love to celebrate with you today. If there's something we can do, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despair.
Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love.
Hey, good morning, church. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for another great day you've given us. Thank you for this time we've had together in worship, whether in person or by video. And God, I'm just praying for the day that we can all get back and assemble together to worship you. Lord, just help us take what we've heard from Randy today. Help us adjust our vision so we can recognize hope in you. Be with our elders, Lord, during these difficult times, and help them to continue to lead us in the way that we need to go. Lord, we pray for our country now. Help us remember that you are in charge of everything, and help us to put you first in everything we do. Lord, be with those that are fighting this horrible virus, and we ask you, Lord, to come and take away this virus and help those that are working on a vaccine to develop one soon. And Lord, just continue to be with all those that are sick in our number and help them every day. And please keep the rest of us all safe this week, Lord. And most of all, though, Lord, thank you for sending your Son to this earth for us. Lord, we just ask you to forgive us of our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, we just have a few announcements before we are dismissed. First of all, you should see our QR code up here. There we go. This is how we are taking attendance and keeping a record of who is worshiping with us. So if you're here with us, then please take a picture of that, and that will take you to our virtual welcome book. If you are at home worshiping with us, then we ask you to do the same thing, and that way we can have a record. Also, if you are our guest today, we invite you to meet with Kevin Rayner, who is at our welcome booth in the foyer here. He has a small gift for you, and we would love to get to know you. Also, at this time, we want to remember those who are experiencing a lot of grief and loss. We have numerous deaths that are connected to people in our congregation, so let's keep those people in our minds and in our prayers. We want to extend our sympathy to Ali Sokolnicki and the death of her father, to Elaine Smith and the death of her mother, Roger Morton and the death of his uncle, Stephanie Hopkins and the death of her grandmother, and Skylar Getzinger and the death of his mother. Let's please make sure that we are being a congregation that is a family and reaching out and supporting and helping those people who are walking through a time of grief and loss right now. At this time, this will be our last Sunday with many of our college students, those who are from OC, and they have put together a video that they would like to show us for now.
We know that this year has been strange.
Unexpected.
Weird.
Abnormal.
Extraordinary. Odd.
Crazy. Unprecedented.
And challenging for all of us.
And we are so thankful to have a church family
that loves us through this exceptional time.
And from all of us, thank you!
Well, thanks for that, guys. We are so happy that you're a part of our congregation, and we are looking forward to our next semester with you guys as well. At this time, we want to remind you of our Thanks for Giving project that's coming up. We're going to be providing meals for those in our congregation and in our community that we want to honor at this time. There's several ways you can get involved. First of all, several of the adult classes will be asked to bring ingredients for those meals, so pay attention there. Your class might also be asked to assist with delivering those meals. If you know an older friend or neighbor or person in our community that we could honor with this, then please submit their name and information to our church office. Also, pray for this project. Be with our hearts and help us to just be able to show honor and thanks to those people who have done so much for our congregation. And also our children are participating by drawing and putting together handmade cards that we will put in those boxes with meals. So if you have a child that would like to participate, there are kits that are out in the foyer today. And if you wanted to pick one of those up, please return it by the 18th, and then they could participate in that project as well. We also want to make you aware of our Surviving the Holidays program, and this is through Grief Share and is useful for people who may be struggling with grief and loss. The holidays can bring up so much of that, and that will be beginning this today at 2:30 in the chapel. So if that is something that would benefit you or somebody that you know, then we would invite you to participate there. Also, we do our Christmas Wish program every year at this time. While it's always a huge benefit, we probably need your help more now than ever. So please think about participating in that. We will have basically the concept is we have a child's name that is put on a stocking and some information about them, and then a family will take that stocking and provide Christmas for that child. Those stockings will be in our foyer starting next Sunday. So if that's something that you could participate in, then that would be much appreciated. At this time, we are dismissed.